As long as I'm right, bismillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, everyone. Welcome back to Qur'an 30 for 30. Sheikh Abdullah, how are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
So I guess the voice is there, but Sheikh Yasir, كيف حالك يا Sheikh Yasir?
Alhamdulillah, fadlu min Allah, alhamdulillah.
Sheikh Abdullah is somewhere.
I'm right here.
I hear him.
You hear him, huh?
Yeah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Someone did steal my light bulb in the back. If everyone saw the light bulb and then the frame, the Muhammad Rasulullah frame, someone stole my light bulb. I can hear him. I don't know what Sheikh Abdullah's doing.
I don't know. You did the angel series, so I don't know what, you know, my
fellow. That's maybe a jinn series now.
MashaAllah.
In all of the glory, I need to then we decided, you know, because it's the last one. The Eid edition, the final edition, Sheikh Abdullah Oduro, alhamdulillah, I mean, in person, in the flesh, alhamdulillah, Sheikh, you need a student more, bismillah. All right. Okay. Can y'all see him? All right, bismillah, rahman, rahim. We're vaccinated, alhamdulillah, just we'll make that disclaimer so that no one worries about us violating anything. We wanted to obviously be together for the last one and, you know, wish everyone, inshallah ta'ala, blessed Eid and say jazakumullah khairan together for everyone that's been tuning in. We formed the little Qur'an 30 for 30 community, alhamdulillah,
mashallah,
that's been here all the time. And we got none other, khitamuhu misk, the best, the best of the best, the cream of the crop, Sheikh Yasir Fahmy, alhamdulillah, ameen. Kif haraka, Sheikh Yasir?
Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, it's so good to be here and sorry, I haven't been here more often, but I'm so blessed to be at least in the last one. Alhamdulillah. May Allah bless you all. I hope all of you are doing well, inshallah.
I know you've been very busy, alhamdulillah. May Allah reward you for all of your efforts. Are you gonna pop in? We got a third space here.
Yeah, I was just thinking. I was like, how do I get into it? I want to do one of those moves where like I go like this and then suddenly I'm in the middle. Ya Rabbi, Allah, may Allah bring us together. May Allah bring us together soon, Ya Rabbi, in person.
Sheikh, how's it going, man?
I'm good. Alhamdulillah, no complaints. I'm here. Alive and well.
In the flesh.
In the flesh.
Alhamdulillah. Everyone's really enjoyed, alhamdulillah, the insights. And honestly, we you know, we know it's a time, subhanAllah. Honestly, we start off with, obviously, the our brothers and sisters in Al-Aqsa and Palestine. We know it's a time of great stress and distress in the Ummah, and we have to keep that connection with the night to our brothers and sisters. And we celebrate the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that comes with Ramadan. And at the same time, we celebrate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a promise. And with the na'i ta'ala, we hope to see that promise, inshallah ta'ala, soon in regards to our brothers and sisters in Al-Aqsa. And we will make a dua for them, inshallah ta'ala, at the end of this session in particular. But, you know, studying the Qur'an has been bringing something into our lives, and alhamdulillah, it's been such a joy, honestly, to sit with Sheikh Abdullah, to sit with the Mashayikh, to sit with all of you, to see the consistent community that's formed around this, and we wanted to just send our appreciation to you all. So, jazakumullah khairan, jazakallah khair, Sheikh Abdullah, jazakallah khair, Sheikh Yasir, for agreeing to be the final special guest, alhamdulillah, that we have. And obviously, because things are a bit different, Sheikh Abdullah, you want to say anything before we get started?
No, alhamdulillah. I mean, it's been a pleasure to go through this Quran with all of you, mashallah, to go to the reflections with the mashayikh, mashallah, and just seeing faces that I haven't seen in a while. And the best way to do it is remembering the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sharing it with the world and hearing the beautiful compliments from you all and reading them. And mashallah, just glad that we have a part in, you know, inspiring others to reignite the Quran in the hearts of the people.
So we're going to do things a little different today. So you all will forgive us. This camera has never had two people on at the same time. So you'll forgive us for being a little tight and snug. The frame's going to be not as professional as usual. But inshallah ta'ala, we'll have a discussion about the most frequently recited juz in the Quran, which is juz amma. And we're going to all just stay on screen together the whole time, inshallah, just and have a discussion. And we want to start actually with you, Sheikh Yasir, because your portion that you're covering is actually the first revelation. The first revelation, subhanAllah, even though it's in the last juz, the very first revelation to our beloved Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, Sheikh, now why don't you get us started with the Nahi Ta'ala?
InshaAllah. Bismillah wa alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ba'd. Alhamdulillah, you know, when we think about the Qur'an, and we think about, if you will, the story of the Qur'an and the narrative of the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He takes us through so many valleys and so many ridges and so many plains, and we, explore historical accounts and legal discourse and spiritual discourse and philosophical discourse and all sorts of, you know, discourses in the Quran that really animate how we think and feel and practice and behave and consider. And, you know, Surah Al-Alaq, this, you know, surah that's nestled in the middle of the 30th juz, commonly known as Surah Iqra. It is a chapter that I think in the Muslim parlance, it has a quality about it that is very intellectual. So people say, oh, we are the ummah of Iqra. That means that we are an intellectual ummah. That's an ummah of read, ummah of, you know, critical thought and analysis. And inshallah, Ya Rab, that is a quality. But I feel like something is lost on us when we take and treat Surah Iqra in that vein, because in it really is the sir, is the secret that unlocks the truth and the reality of the Quran. What is the access point? What is the critical access point to process everything we've just studied over the past 30 days and really, you know, have it gel with our spirits, have it something that is functional in our lives? And the secret is, I believe, in Surah Iqra. Because I challenge, and perhaps I would love to hear the Mashaykh's insights on this, that it's not an intellectual surah, it's a deeply spiritual surah. And what do I mean by that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down Sayyiduna Jibreel in that early moment, in that initial moment in the cave of Hira. The example, the story, the incident that we are all intimately familiar with, so I won't repeat its details. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is grasped, and he's grabbed, and he's held, and he's constricted by Sayyiduna Jibreel. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had enjoyed being in the cave of Hira for all those years, you know, reflecting and contemplating fit tahannuth. And then Jibreel comes and he shocks the system of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it was a very, you know, if you will, in many ways, distressing moment or an unsettling reality that he had experienced. And the command that he is commanded with, which is Iqra, read. The response by the Prophet ﷺ is, Ma ana biqari, I don't know how to read. Now, this is not just a negation of the lettered word. The Prophet ﷺ was not presented with, you know, exact letters of the Arabic language presented to him and told to read. This was not like a test in a school. This was a command, an injunction to proceed, to read, to process, and to look at the entirety of the divine reality. To read, as Imam Al-Ghazali says, Kitabullahi al-Mastur wa Kitabullahi al-Manzur, the book of Allah that is penned, and the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is seen. And so when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is negating his capacity to read, It's not an intellectual negation, meaning that, you know, I don't have the requisite intellectual tools to be able to do this. No, this is a negation of the fullness of his capacity, not just intellect, but also body, and more critically, spirit. That I don't know how to actually engage this reality, you know, I don't know how to proceed forth. I'm paralyzed in my moment. And so he is commanded again, Iqra. I don't know. I don't know. Ma ana biqari. He's negating himself, negating his capacity. And a third time, he negates, and then the Prophet is told, and the revelation is sent, that then becomes the essence, the spiritual and theological essence that then unlocks the doors and the gateways and opens up the true vestiges of reality. And that is when he's told, Iqra bismi rabbik, read in the name of your Lord. And the article ba, the letter ba in the Arabic language, according to Ibn Hisham, has upwards of 17 meanings. And so the letter ba, asirru, the secret is actually in the letter ba. You know, so you just put ba as like a title of a book, and the whole story is actually behind the letter ba. Why? Because it is only through the conduit of Bismillah that you and I can ever function or process or even conceive of anything. Mashallah. Because that means iqra bi'aunillah. You read by the aid of Allah. Iqra bi-sababillah. Read because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Read by the aid of Allah. Read by the support of Allah. Read by the opening of Allah. And read in the name of Allah. And so in the conduit of al-ba'iyya, you want to call it that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is then able to now see. Iqra bismi rabbik alladhi khalaq. Khalaq al-insana min alaq. You know, now, O Muhammad, you read. And you notice, after he was told, Iqra bismi rabbik, there's no more negation. There's no more recognition that I am incapable. No, billahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am very capable, you know. And it is that essential prism that I believe all of us have to internalize. Because if we want to unlock the truth of the Qur'an, see, it's not an intellectual project. There are, you know, one of the things that I do is I teach a class at Harvard. There are people there who have studied Islam for decades, right? For decades. And they critically analyze and they assess and they study fiqh and law and philosophy and theology, all sorts of things. But they haven't read the Qur'an. You know, they may have read it, وَلَمْ يَقْرَأُوهَا. You know, they've read it, but they haven't read it. And for you and I who actually want to read the Qur'an, you know, we want to understand the Qur'an. We want to revel in the glory of the Qur'an. And not only in the book of Allah that is revealed to us, the sacred text, but we want to see the maqru', which is the reality of the divine revelation in creation, which is we want to perceive and understand and internalize and process, then it categorically requires بِسْمِ رَبِّكَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ. In the name of your Lord, the one who created you. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ says, "Kullu amrin dhibal la yubda'u bi bismillahi fahuwa aqta." Every matter of concern that does not begin with "in the name of Allah." Don't forget now, the ba has many meanings to it. Anything that does not begin with that, it is cut off. Cut off from what? From the barakah of Allah, from the aid of Allah, from the support of Allah, from the tawfiq of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who teaches us. He shows us. He helps us to perceive. He opens up our eyes. He opens up our hearts. He gives us perspective. He gives us certainty. He gives us confidence. He gives us understanding. It's all a divine reality that has to then be facilitated for us. We can agonize with our minds all we want, but if there's no fatah, if there is no, you know, basmala, it will always be just a function of my very simple logical capacity. And so I pray that, you know, as we're exiting Ramadan and we're exiting the Quran, you know, just this iteration of our going through the Quran, that we take this spirit of the basmala to govern how we read and to bring life to the Quran. Because, and I'll pass off the mic with this, the surah, what's the name of the surah in the Quran? Al-Alaq. Al-Alaq is a clot. Lifeless. It's a clot. How do you bring life to a clot? Bismillah. We are all just a clot. We are this meaty entity that's lifeless, soulless, has nothing in it. It is only billahi, by the spirit of Allah, by the aid of Allah, in the name of Allah, that we come to life. And so it's a powerful metaphor for if you want to engage these lettered words, because you're reading letters, you're reading words, you're reading sentences. If you want life to come into these words, it's only done billahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nas'al Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala an yuhyi qulubana bil Quran.
Jazakallah khair. Subhanallah, that's a rich start and honestly a rich ending to the entire series of Quran 30 for 30. One of the things I always reflect on with people is that, you know, a lot of people don't know how to make dua anymore. So they're kind of waiting for someone else to make dua so I can say ameen. And when it comes to tadabbur on the Qur'an, contemplating upon the Qur'an and its meanings, you're not supposed to do tafsir as an average Muslim. But to sit with it and to bismillah, open it and open your heart to it and ponder upon it and read it very carefully. And then reflect those meanings into your daily life and bring that meaning into your daily life. SubhanAllah, there's life. And you will truly find the Qur'an giving you life on a consistent basis. And so when we just sit together and do tadabbur on it, we reflect upon it. Obviously, we do the tafsir background of the ayat, and then we reflect on it together. This is how we're given life through this revelation. وَمَنْ كَانَ مَيْتًا فَأَحْيَيْنَاهُ وَجَعَلْنَا لَهُ نُورًا. Was he not dead and we gave him life? The life that comes through the Qur'an gives us light, and the light in the heart allows us to receive the life of the Qur'an. So it's this constant synchrony that we have to find between the two. And subhanAllah, I know Sheikh Abdullah, you were going to talk about Surah Al-Duha, right? And so the whole Juz Amma is tafsirah, right? It's all seerah, you know? It truly is all seerah. And Surah Al-Duha is also talking about, you know, and we know it's this long period where the Prophet ﷺ does not receive revelation. After this moment strikes him, and after some of these moments, and the Prophet ﷺ does not get to dictate when Jibreel alayhi salam comes to him. So it's not just like, Bismillah, now I can receive it. So, you know, now we have a schedule with Jibreel alayhi salam, where you're going to come to me every day at this time and you're going to give me the next chapter. It is still, وَمَا نَتَنَزِلُ إِلَّا بِأَمْرِ رَبِّكَ. We don't come except by the command of your Lord. So the Prophet ﷺ now knows Jibreel alayhi salam. He misses him, and he wants him to come to him more frequently because he needs the next chapter to unveil for him so that he can take the next step in his own prophetic life. And he does not, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى. He doesn't speak or act from his own sight, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As far as Surah Al-Duha, Allah reminds the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as he reminds us as a human, as a human creation, you were alaq, you're a clot, and Allah gave you life. And in the case of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the revelation that gave life to the world through his example. Surah Al-Duha is also then, hey, you know, reminding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it reminds the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of the favors of Allah upon him. Adam yajidka yatiman fa'awa, wa wajadaka dhalan fahada, wajadaka a'inan fa'aghna. So truly, we're always coming from nothingness to something. Bismillah, bi amrillah, by the permission and the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Sheikh, can you share some of your reflections on Duha for us, inshallah ta'ala, as well?
No, jazakallah khair. Bismillah, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi man wala amma ba'd. Mashallah, you hit it hit the nail on the head. I mean, subhanAllah, it's really, when I think of Duha, I think of comfort. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comforting all of us. But, you know, when he speaks to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's a risal and it's a message for all of us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts off by swearing by his creation. As we know, Allah is the only one that has the authority to do so, but he's showing you the importance of it. It also shows the nobility of these created things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, after A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, wa duha, by the daybreak. As some scholars have mentioned, there's different opinions of what duha would mean. Either it's the daybreak when it starts, or it is the whole daytime, or some even mention Salat al-Duha. In any case, we understand that Allah is swearing by something that he has created to show the importance of the matter and to show the greatness of that which he has created. Then he says, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى, and by the night when it grows still, or when it covers, يُغَطِّي الْأَرْضِ, it covers the earth. I mean, the nighttime is dark. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by two different time frames or two different events that take place. Then after that, he comforts all of us. He comforts the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he says, مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. Your Lord has not forsaken you. He hasn't left you. مَا وَدَّعَكَ. He hasn't left you. And he hasn't shown any distress, or he hasn't, some scholars would translation would say hate, but it's more of he hasn't distressed you or shown any dislike towards you. He hasn't left you. He is here, and he will always be here, subhanahu. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by these forms of creation and shows and comforts him, look, I am still here and I'm going to give you this revelation. I am al-hafidh. I am the preserver. I am the one bismi. You know, in my name, all of these beautiful attributes will be showered upon you and those that take the characteristics that you exemplify within your life. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when mentioning that he did not leave and he did not leave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that he will never show any hatred or distress towards him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. So to remind him that the next life is better than that which is in the beginning, or that which is al-ula, in the past. So when understanding that the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swearing by these time frames and showing and bringing the reality to him and reminding him to stay the course and reminding all of us, subhanAllah, to remember the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to remember that Allah will never leave us as long as we do whatever we do, bismillah, as was mentioned before. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues on and he says, "Wa lasawfa yu'tika rabbuka fatarda." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you and will provide for you to the degree that you will be pleased, to show you that, look, I will always be here. Don't ever give up. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always there. But to remember, as Sheikh Omar mentioned earlier, when it comes to when the revelation will come, it comes bi amri rabbik. It comes by when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants it and when he chooses for it to happen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues on and he says, now that he mentions that he will always be there and that you will be pleased with what is coming up next to comfort and console the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it should be a waqfa for us. It should be a stopping point for us to pause and say, you know what? All of these things that I'm facing in my life, I should realize from what I take a step back. And when I say Bismillah, as Sheikh Yasir mentioned so eloquently and beautifully, you know, Bismillah in your names and your beautiful attributes to be showered upon me based on the particular context. So when you read Bismillah, it's fi hifdillah min ash-shaytan, protection from the shaytan. All of these beautiful names and attributes, when we have that, we recognize the promise of Allah is true and it will always be there. And that's important for us to remember, especially in times of hardship, when we hear with what is going on with our brothers and sisters in Masjid Al-Aqsa and all around the world, we have to take the step back and remember and have our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because if we didn't have Allah, mahtadayna, wa ma tsaddaqna wa ma sallayna. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said when they were digging the trench, you know, lola Allah, if we didn't have Allah, mahtadayna, we wouldn't be guided. We wouldn't give charity and we wouldn't even pray, you know? So remembering that it's ultimately with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then transitions and reminds you of the ni'am as-sabiqa. He reminds you of the previous blessings. Alam yajidka yatiman fa'awa. Were you not found, or do we not find you? Did he not find you as an orphan? And then he gave you a place of sleep, a place of refuge, fa'awa. What's interesting here is that Allah mentions fa'awa when he says, and he did not shelter you. He doesn't say shelter you in the Arabic language. He says fa'awa. He didn't say fa'awak. And what scholars mention here is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it wasn't khas, it wasn't specific to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That sheltering is for all of creation and all of those that may find a particular situation to where there may be sadness in their life. It's for you to remember what Allah has done. Remember that he has sheltered you and others in you. As scholars say, awaka wa awabika. So as he mentioned, you know, Sheikh Yasir, I remember one of my shuyukh, he was teaching me Arabic, he said, the istikhdam haruf jar min as'ab ashaf al-lugh al-arabiyya. The using of the, for lack of better words, prepositions, you know, in Arabic we call harf jar. This is the hardest science and the hardest discipline within the Arabic language when studying it, because it has so many different meanings within them. So when we see here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, shelter you and sheltered with you, meaning that you brought shelter to the companions with the hijrah, you know, you brought this shelter with them. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions after that, وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. And he found you lost and then guided. In the translations, we understand guided you, like in هَدَاكَ وَهَدَابِكَ. He guided you and used you as a means of guidance to the people. هِدَايَةَ الْإِرْشَادِ. Showing the people the way. Not enabling them to go the way. As we know, Abu Talib, إِنَّكَ لَا تَحْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتِ. You know, he didn't even become Muslim. So we see here, subhanAllah, that the prophets are there to show the way. It's up to that person to actually go the way. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds him of this second blessing, that he found him as, subhanAllah, someone that was lost and he guided him. So, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانُ وَلَكِنْ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُورًا الْآيَةِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying here, that the iman of the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sharia, that some would say, is that which was not there with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But he was always a muwahhid, as Sheikh Yasir said, kana yatahannath fi, you know, in the cave. He would always call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And even some of the companions, such as some scholars mentioned, Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, and others. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding him of that past. And it's important for us, when we see these three blessings, the first of them being that he was lost, and then the second, وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى, and did he not find you in need, and he made you self-sufficient. فأغنى أغنى وأغنى بك. That he made you self-sufficient and he made you be a means of the self-sufficiency for others, meaning that they were those people that had Islam. They had the blessings of Islam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding them of that second blessing. And then he says, فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling him now the responsibility. So as some scholars say, he reminded him of the previous blessings to show him the blessings that are coming in the future. So now that he reminded him of these blessings, there's a responsibility. Just as you were a yatim, لَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَأَوَى فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ. Just as you were like that in the past, or you are that, there are those that are yatim, so do not be of those that are harsh with the orphan. La taqhar. Wa amma sa'ila fala tanhar. And also for the one that is asking, do not chide them or to be rude to them when they ask. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that blessing when he said, wa wajadaka dhalan fahada. Just as you were misguided, or you were the one that was lost at that time, when someone comes to ask you, and as some scholars mention, when they ask you about the ahkam of the sharia or ask you about Islam, don't turn away from them. Don't turn them away. So remember the previous blessings when it comes to people that may ask of you or may have the characteristics that you once had. كَذَلِكَ كُنْتُ مِنْ قَبْلُ فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. Remember those previous blessings and do not allow those blessings to make you of those that are arrogant. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى, just as he made you someone that was in need and made you self-sufficient, that self-sufficiency that has been given to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, speak about it to the people. Mention the blessings of Allah that Allah has given you. But make sure when you mention it, it is in praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mention those times that you were the yatim or something that was yatim-like, or you were someone that was lost. As many times of those that convert to Islam or those that were Muslim and they had an epiphany, they remember those days. But use that as a means. Don't leave the conversation with that. Stop and say, you know what? If it wasn't for Allah, mahtadayna, we would not be guided. So using that as a means to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to where hopefully what we do in the future is always, inshallah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So mashallah, that's a beautiful chapter for us to remember, that we should remember the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us and use that as a means to thank him and to tell others to thank him, to remind others to thank him as well.
Sheikh Yasir, I see you
enjoying. I'm downloading. No, I mean, my mind went in like maybe 70 directions as he was speaking.
Give us 50 for directions.
I'll give you a percentage of the directions. Yeah. No, subhanAllah, barakAllah feekum, Shaykh Abdullah, zaydakAllahu min fadli, and may Allah always make you in the Qur'an, ya Rabbi. When Shaykh Abdullah was talking about ma wadda'aka rabbuka wa ma qala, I felt that, that's a very, I think that's a very powerful, all the meanings are very powerful. It's, and I think that meaning is something that perhaps resonates with a lot of us, the idea of, because we feel that we feel alone, we feel that we are out there kind of, not able to figure things out, and we feel distressed, whether it's the circumstances of our own home, our own lives, or just watching something like Palestine transpire. We feel, ما ودعك ربك وما قالك, not only did he not let you go or did he turn away from you, but he hasn't cut you off. You're not cut off. None of us are cut off, And I think that's a very powerful theological idea to internalize. The fact that Allah has not cut us off. Allah is not away from us. Allah has not, disregarded us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very present. Hayyun qayyum, right? And I think that, as we're journeying through this journey of the Quran and journey of life, the critical narrative that ensures that these ma'ani, these meanings are very present in our hearts, is that very humble connectedness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because, the basmala The basmala was commanded in the context of humility. What I mean by that is, it was after the Prophet ﷺ was physically humbled by Sayyidina Jibreel, intellectually humbled by Sayyidina Jibreel. Not to say that he was arrogant, hasha sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but there was a type of a humbling process where for you to actually receive revelation, you have to be categorically negated. So the Prophet ﷺ was fully humbled emotionally, psychologically, spiritually, intellectually, and physically. So when he was in that fully humble disposition, he was told, okay, say Bismillah. You know, now you say Bismillah. And that's important because I don't want us to say Bismillah, but we're still like, you know, we're still on our heads. You know, we're still really charged up here. You know what I mean? Like, we have our ideas, we have our perspectives, we're moving at like 1,000 miles per hour. And then like Sheikh Omar says, say Bismillah. So, okay, Bismillah. And then, you know, you're still, you have to stop. You have to really humble yourself. You have to actually negate yourself. You have to say, okay, you know, what do I know? What do I know about life? I've been agonizing over my circumstances at home for all these years. But have I really humbled myself to the divine reality, to the qada and the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And so, you know, as we're trying to really journey through life, fully aware and conscious with a disposition of taqwa, really conscientious of what's happening around us, and also having that warmth and that feeling that Allah is close to me and has never cut me off, then, you know, the precondition to the basmala is a disposition of profound humility. We have to lower ourselves to Allah. We have to negate ourselves. We have to stop relying upon ourselves. Don't rely on your logic. Don't rely on governments. Don't rely on circumstances. Don't rely on your finances. Don't rely on your thoughts. Certainly don't ever rely on your feelings. Probably one of the most devastating things that we can do is rely on our feelings or trust our feelings. And it's the greatest inhibitor from humility and from the muftah, from the key of the basmala. So that humility, I pray, will help us really, you know, find the prism of the basmala, opening up every possible purview, not just on a personal life, on a level, but that we can even look at Palestine through a divine lens, and that it nourishes our souls and gives us fortification and confidence, and then compels us to get up and be and exist the way Sheikh Abdullah was noting. The end of Surah Al-Daha is about, okay, you got to get up and go, you got to work, you know, قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ قُمْ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا, stand, pray, stand, call, stand and be existent. And the Prophet ﷺ, قَامَ وَلَمْ يَقْعُدْ, you know, at the beginning of Revelation, he was دَثِرُونِي دَثِرُونِي زَمِّلُونِي زَمِّلُونِي, but then he was commanded to قُمْ, stand, وَلَمْ يَقْعُدْ, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
SubhanAllah, we didn't plan it this way, but my reflection actually builds on the reflections that you'll have. And I think before, SubhanAllah, before I even start, like, isn't anytime you measure the Prophet against any trait, you find him to have the best of it. And sometimes we might not make those connections. So for example, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The greatest blessing a person can have, from our perspective, is to learn the Qur'an, right? And then to teach the Qur'an. And the Prophet ﷺ said, the best of you are those who learn the Qur'an and then teach it. There's no greater gift than guidance. And so giving guidance, right? And Allah gives guidance through you, of course, in that regard. But the Prophet ﷺ was taught the Qur'an by Shadid al-Quwa through Jibreel alayhi salam. And look how the Prophet ﷺ took that blessing and dedicated himself to giving it to the world. Right, so Adam yajidka yatiman fa'awa wa wajadaka dhalan fahada. Like, it's more material, for example, when you think or easier to quantify when you think about like the way he took care of the orphans, alayhi salatu wasalam. Mm-hmm. Like, he really responded, you know, his whole life, even before revelation, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam loved the aytam, he loved the orphans because he was an orphan. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like he wasn't acting on that blessing. Him and Khadija radiallahu anha, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam and Khadija radiallahu anha were known, right, for the way they were taking care of the orphans. I mean, look at Zayd radiallahu ta'ala anhu, though he wasn't an orphan, even a lower position in society, an orphan and a slave. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, he was given ghina through the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wealth and self-sufficiency. Mm-hmm. And beyond just kafala, beyond just taking him in, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam adopted him and loved him and taught him in that regard, subhanAllah. So the Prophet ﷺ was acting on these blessings. He was a grateful person, as you said very very truthfully, that he didn't need to be humbled out of a sense of like an arrogant person being humbled, but to be open to the full capacity to receive revelation. And so the one word that really shows is وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. You were seeking and Allah guided you. So look how the Prophet ﷺ took this Qur'an and then tried to give it to the world through speech and through action. عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ أَثَانِهِمْ. Like subhanAllah, to a point where you're going to hurt yourself, or it's like you're so grieved, so deeply grieved about their destiny now, about them receiving the warning properly, receiving the glad tidings properly, receiving this revelation properly. So the way he channels that alayhi salatu wasalam so beautifully. And what I was going to reflect on, subhanAllah, is that the Qur'an, if you have not fully come to appreciate, and we can never come to really fully appreciate the blessing of how coherent the Qur'an is, because sometimes it hits you when you're reading it over and over and over again. Juz Amma is not random. Like, it's not like, not just that every surah connects to each other and it tells a story, but Juz Amma basically packs the entire 29 ajza that come before it, the 29 chapters that come before it. And here is your simplified guide, right? Like, everything comes back. Now that you've read all this, here's your reminder. So how does the Quran start? After Al-Fatiha, Alif Lam Mim, Dhalika Al-Kitabu, La Rayba Fi. This is the book in which there is no doubt. How does Juz Amma start? Amma yatasa'alun 'ani naba'il 'azim. What are they asking about? They're asking about this very consequential great news that's coming to them, that's telling them about the reality of that which they see and the reality of that which they don't see yet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tasks them with that. And that's, you know, and basically this news dropped, the Quran comes, and it sends society into a scramble. Right? Because now you have to respond to this news. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those who believe in the unseen. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. And they establish the prayer. And what do we find? وَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. Allah warns the people who pray in Juz Amma, those who are forgetful in their prayers. الَّذِينَ يُرَاءُونَ وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَعُونَ. They show off with their prayers. And they're not just inhibited from receiving the full meaning of prayer, but they are inhibitors to others for receiving the blessings that prayer is supposed to unlock within a person. So the connection of al-ghayb, the belief in the unseen, to now establishing the prayer. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And they spend on this message. They invest. They give of their wealth, of themselves, of their families, of everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Read Surah Al-Layl about Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The greatest response that you could have to revelation, right? He does not do anything. وَمَا يُغْنِي عَنْهُ مَالُهُ. You know, when we talk about the person who tried to buy himself out of things, his money cannot avail him whatsoever. Right, so the Abu Lahabs of the world, the Abu Jahas of the world, their money did them no good. وَيْنٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Woe to those people who thought that they could get away with their wealth and their connections. With Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he does none of this. He spends everything he has for what? إِلَّا بِتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. Seeking the pleasure of his Lord the Most High, and Allah will please him. So it's like you have the manifestation of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu in Surah Al-Layl. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنْزِلَ إِلَيْكَ. Those who believe in that which came before you. إِنَّ هَذَا لَفِي الصُّحُفِ الْأُولَى صُحُفِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى سُورَةُ الْأَعْلَى. This is in the previous books. This same message has been embedded in the words of Abraham and Moses, peace be upon them. Peace be upon them. It has come through the ways of the prophets and the scriptures that came before. The same message over and over again, to believe in Allah and the last day, and to exert yourself in that regard. And subhanAllah, what does Allah do in the beginning? He categorizes people, categorizes the believers, categorizes the disbelievers, categorizes the hypocrites. And what does Allah tell us that the disbelievers are going to do? The ones that insist on their disbelief. سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. You warn them or you don't warn them, they're still not going to believe. Now, who's the first example Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us in Juz Amma? Go to Fir'aun. اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى فقل هل لك إلى أن تزكى وهديك إلى ربك فتخشى. just say to him, speak to him these good words and say, look, are you interested in purifying yourself and being guided to your Lord? And so you'll have the awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأَرَاهُ الْآيَةُ الْكُبْرَى. And he gave him all the signs, right? But what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتُهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. So you warn them or you don't warn them, they're not going to believe. So what does Fir'aun respond with? فَكَذَّبَ وَعَصَى ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى فَحَشَرَ فَنَادَى فَقَالَ أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. Like literally a madman. A madman. Allah gives us Fir'aun as a madman. And this, like, are you crazy? He immediately, instead of being purified, he loses it to the point that he says, I am your Lord the Most High. Instead of Al-A'la. I am your Lord the Most High. Like the opposite of that. SubhanAllah. So it's like, that's your example there.
Yeah.
And then finally, like from a seerah perspective, the two most highlighted personalities, right? To a point that there are surahs that are very clearly about them. Abasa and Tabbat Yada Abi Lahab and Watab. People, you know, that will take this reminder, expand themselves to it, and so Allah will expand them individually and expand the ummah through them, and expand the blessings and the victory of this ummah through them. Allah says to the Prophet ﷺ, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِي يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهًا. Early on throughout the Qur'an, keep patient, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with those people that call upon Allah day and night. They have listened to this revelation. They want this revelation. They want to grow with this revelation. To grow and to grow. To grow within and to grow outside of themselves. To grow and to grow. Right, the way that you were talking about Surah Al-Duha. Keep patient with those people. It doesn't matter if they don't have status. Allah will give them status through this Quran. And what does Allah tell us? Subhanallah, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى. Subhanallah, like the opposite of Fir'aun, this lowest person from these superficial standards in society, Abdullah ibn Maktum radiallahu ta'ala anhu, a person of low economic status, disability, looked down upon in every way. And he comes to the Prophet ﷺ while the Prophet ﷺ is speaking to these elites who have shut their hearts to the revelation. And Allah says, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى. He was coming to you to be purified. Focus on him. Allah honored Abdullah ibn Maktum radiallahu ta'ala anhu in this juz, right? Puts him up on this high pedestal to the point that the Prophet ﷺ would say, welcome to the one on whose behalf Allah admonished me. Like, what an amazing person you are. The Prophet ﷺ elevates him because he was elevated through the Qur'an. And then what happens? Abu Lahab, the one who stood up in the very beginning and cursed the Prophet ﷺ and said, may you perish. Allah humiliated the most honorable man in society from those superficial standards, put him down, sealed his fate and sealed his name with disbelief and rebellion until the end of times. Remember, the revelation started with the Prophet or the revelation to the public, the Prophet standing on Safa, calling the people. And Abu Lahab stood up, proud, arrogant, and challenged the Messenger, and no one was with the Prophet that day except for Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And subhanAllah, that's how the da'wah of the Prophet started. The Quran ends, one of the last surahs, with now what happens? Abu Lahab perishes. Abu Lahab remains in a state of regret and remorse, in a state of punishment because of the way that he did not take this Quran seriously. And so we end, you know, with obviously fasta'ith billah. When you hear the Quran being recited, seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from anything that will get in between. Min al-jinnati wa nas, the human devils, the jinn devils, the whispers, the distractions, the wealth, the palaces, the superficial titles. Seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the Quran ends with, right, isti'adah. It begins with it and it ends with seeking refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to whom there is no escape from except to. There is no refuge from Allah except to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those that receive the Quran and that are given life through the Quran, and that give life through the Quran, and make us those people of Quran. Allahumma ameen. Yeah. So, any reflections, thoughts, inshallah, then we'll
say yes.
MashaAllah.
So, Yasir, you need to come here physically.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out how to do that right now. I was going to ask Sheikh Abdullah to give me some of his powers, because he powers that he used to in the beginning of the session. You know, subhanAllah, I really hope and pray that all of us are internalizing. Sheikh Omar said a lot of very beautiful things right now in terms of taking us through kind of the types of people who engage the Book of Allah, who engage revelation, how we process, how we think of it. And the buttoning up of this story, if you will, is what he ended off with, which is the refuge. You know, and really, it's so beautiful that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends this entire very powerful narrative of the Qur'an with all of its machinations. And he ends off by telling us, always be in my awth, always be in my refuge. Always come and seek me and find your comfort with me. Find your protection with me. And you know, we spoke about, you know, the basmala being this prism, this gateway into ma'rifah, into knowing, and the humility that we take in that, in using and utilizing that prism. But then it's a journey that must be in the refuge, in the divine refuge. You know, we can never really be alone in this world, and we can never be alone in the afterlife. We always need his refuge. We need his comfort. We need his protection. جَلَّ فِي عُلَىٰ اللَّهُمَّ لَا تَكِلْنَا إِلَىٰ أَنفُسِنَا طَرْفَةَ عَيْنَ أَوْ أَقَلَّ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. Oh Allah, do not relinquish us to ourselves even for the blink of an eye or less than that. So, you know, as we're exiting this time in our journey through the 30 ajza, please make sure that what you take away is, number one, I really know nothing. I really understand very little. Perhaps my feelings that have been cultivated within me over the years, my ideas of morality, my ideas of justice, my ideas of virtue, my ideas of good and bad, right and wrong, perhaps these all have been just, you know, subjective, relative developments over just the time that I've spent going to school, going to work, whatever, living in society, consuming media. And now maybe I make a decision to say, okay, I'm going to completely humble myself in front of the divine. I'm going to latch on to the his reality, say Bismillah as a, you know, as a permission, say Ya Rabbi, you know, Bismika. I enter into this world of the Quran by your name, wallahi, by your permission, by your aid, because of you, I'm surrendering to this reality. And then as you're going throughout the journey, A'udhu billah, Ya Rabbi, I seek your refuge, I seek your comfort, I seek your security. And when you envelop yourself, you know, outwardly with the divine refuge and inwardly with the basmala as a spirit that's driving you, I believe that, you know, we can soar through this dunya, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. And we can not only make sense, because you see, the Prophet ﷺ, initially, he was just trying to make sense of things. You know, was he not? Was it not the case, Mawlana? Was he not just trying to make sense? He was going to Ghar Hira to make sense. But what he exited the Ghar with was something far more profound than just having now the ability to understand. وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا means found you seeking. And so we gave you guidance, but he gave him much more than that. He gave him purpose. He gave him identity. He gave him now a mission, a driving force, and an unwavering, you know, commitment to the path of the divine. And that's the difference between hidayah and rushd. You know, rushd is when you are, you know, I liken it sometimes to people like this way. See, it's one thing, hidayah is to know that guidance exists, or to know that that's the pathway, or to have been on the path and off the path, etc. But to be rashid, to be on the path of rushd, is that you're on the path firmly grounded. You know, your feet are not going anywhere. You're fully confident. You know exactly where you're going. It's unwavering. It's profound. They can throw anything at you, you know, offer you every offering, threaten you with every threat. Wallahi, if you put the sun in my right and the moon in my left, I'm not going to leave this. That's the reality of rushd. And so perhaps the Prophet ﷺ, he entered in seeking hidayah and he received, you know, rushd. He received, you know, a profound reality. And that's what's in store for us. You know, we come to Ramadan, I think, with a very low bar of mutatallibat. Like, Allah, give me health, give me a family, give me a wife. Alhamdulillah, ya Rab, Allahumma razuqna jami'an. But there's something far greater for us. And wallahi, there's something far greater for us than just emotional well-being. Don't lower your bar so much. There's something far more profound than just understanding and clarity. There is rush, there is a driving force, a purpose to live through and towards. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ was able to give, and to give not just to this his generation, but to give to the entirety of creation, ila yawmiddin. فَنَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى that he makes us a truly Qur'anic people, and a truly prophetic people, because the themes of yaqeen are, you know, the prophetic orientation, right? And so it's a prophetic reality that is, you know, immersed in the Qur'anic spirit. May Allah bless us all with that, ya Rabbil Alameen.
No, mashallah, beautiful points mentioned, alhamdulillah. Mashallah, I'm speechless.
Jazakumullah khair, Shaykh. SubhanAllah, it's been a journey, and I think, you know, with everyone, we hope in the Naitana that you will continue to stay connected to the Quran throughout. Last Ramadan, we had, after Ramadan was over, we did keeping connected with the Quran for a month. You know, we did some things there as well. You know, and the reality is, SubhanAllah, that it's very easy to kind of fall off now, right? But, you know, the way that you ensure is just like right after Eid, you get back to fasting, six Shawwal. You finish your Ramadan khatam, get back to your Shawwal khatam, or your next khatam, whether it's going to take 3 months, 2-3 months, 4 months, whatever it is. But let me start Alif Lam Mim Dhalika Al-Kitab Wa La Rayba Fihi once again, and get back at it and revisit these lessons. You know, SubhanAllah, this, I don't know, man, you just need to come here. I think next year, so yes, first of all, we have a commitment next year for Quran 30 for 30, inshallah.
Oh, okay, inshallah, yeah. Bismillah.
Season 3, inshallah, if Allah gives us life.
Inshallah.
See, as I brought him here, if I get him to commit on camera, is no. Inshallah. Sheikh Yasir, we have a commitment from you that you're not going to leave us till Juz Amma to come.
Yeah, no, inshallah, next year we'll do much earlier, but at this point, I mean, given the fact that it's Quran 30 for 30, so you need a minimum of 30 seasons, because you have to have, you have to have the 30th anniversary of the 30 for 30. I just,
you it's never really, know.
It'll be our children, you know, giving time, so.
My Khadija and your Khadija and Arwa and all of them reflecting, inshallah, you never know. You know, may Allah is generous. Allah is most generous. So yes, with the night time, we'll be back, inshallah, next year if Allah gives us life and the ability to do so. Mm-hmm. Quran 30 for 30. But I honestly want to share with everyone, revisit these lessons frequently. Like, so just like you're not going to do Quran only in Ramadan,
right?
Revisit these lessons. Like this juz, I'll probably go back and watch this one a few times, mm-hmm. honestly, just to fully perceive what both of you shared, because it was really profound and impactful. So, you know, I hope this juz amma doesn't get lost, you know, with after the 27th night, everyone kind of takes it easy. No, like, by the way, all of you that are watching and have been part of this, share this inshallah ta'ala, this particular reflection, and tell people to engage it in the nighttime. Go back and engage the lessons from the various mashayikh that we've had, alhamdulillah, Rabbi, Sheikh Abdullah, and keep connected, inshallah. Keep connected and keep making dua. And we hope in the nighttime that we will continue to, you know, we'll take a few days off, inshallah. Let Sheikh Abdullah relax for Eid. But no, we'll continue, inshallah ta'ala, to do as much as we can, inshallah, to keep connected with the yaqeen community that's online. We really appreciate your support. Yes. We appreciate your du'as. We appreciate all the support that you've given. Alhamdulillah. I mean, we appreciate the comments that you've sent in. And, you know, we ask for your du'as for everyone on the team, inshallah ta'ala. Sheikh Yasir, his whole family, Sheikh Abdullah's whole family, my family, all the people behind the scenes. I had shared about, you know, Brother Fozy, who was actually, you know, producing, you know, the Meeting Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam series, and his father passed away. SubhanAllah, 27th of Ramadan. SubhanAllah, I mean, that's really something, you know. May Allah have mercy on him. You know, he's one member of this team, and there's a bunch of people that have been producing these different series, and a bunch of people that have been producing curriculum and working on engineering and creative. Make dua, please, for all of their families. And of course, make dua for Al-Aqsa, for our Uyghur brothers and sisters, for our brothers and sisters that are striving and struggling all over the world. And inshallah, as we wish everyone, you know, to finish Ramadan strong, take advantage of these very last moments, and we wish you a blessed Eid. We also want to you know, once again impress upon everyone, keep Al-Aqsa and the people of Al-Aqsa, these murabitun in your dua. And inshallah, with that, Sheikh Yasir, can I ask you to close us off with the night? It's our last session of Qur'an 30 for 30 for a dua for our brothers and sisters in Al-Aqsa, and for a dua for all of us to also keep connected to the Qur'an after Ramadan.
Bismillah. Let's everyone raise your hand, because when you raise your hand, إن الله يستحي أن يردهما صفرا خائبتين. Allah is, you know, shy to allow our hands to descend without having put something in them. So we pray in our humble disposition with our hands raised as beggars to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah, الواحد الأحد الفرد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وفي الآخرين في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. يا الله, we come to you in these last remaining moments of Ramadan. We come to you in this sacred time, a time that you have destined and decreed as being sacred and beloved to you. Ya Allah, we come to you as humble servants, asking you by your infinite wisdom and your boundless mercy, in your beautiful grace, to shower us, our families, our loved ones, and this ummah with your manifest and beautiful mercy. Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim. We ask you to envelop us in your mercy and your tranquility and your lutf. Ya Latiful Lutf Bina. You are the subtly graceful one. And we ask you, Ya Allah, to exact your lutf upon all of us. Mm-hmm. Ya Allah, we come to you in this month, and we have all sorts of difficulties and realities that we are struggling with in inwardly and outwardly. We have difficulties and issues that are weighing heavily upon our hearts and our minds and our souls, and heavily upon our communities and our societies. And we ask you, Ya Allah, the one who brought relief to your prophets, we ask you to bring us relief, to bring us wellness, to bring us shifa, to bring us healing, and to grant us tawfiq, success. Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, we ask you to make the Qur'an the spring of our hearts and the light of our chests. Ya Allah, make us a truly Qur'anic people who live by the Qur'an and who die by the Qur'an, who are motivated by the Qur'an, who are inspired by the Qur'an, who contemplate the Qur'an, who memorize the Qur'an, who live by it and die by it and are resurrected with it. Ya Allah, allow it to be our anis in the afterlife. Allow the Qur'an to be our close companion in our graves. And may the Qur'an be a shafia for us on the Day of Judgment. Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, we ask you to envelop us in the prophetic reality. Allow us to truly be a prophetic people who live in the way of the walking Qur'an, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allow us to walk his walk and talk his talk, and behave as he behaved, and act as he acted, and have his beautiful character, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ya Allah, fortify our hearts and our minds and our spirits the way that you fortified his heart and his mind and his spirit, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ya Allah, make Islam, Iman, and Ihsan beautiful in all of our hearts, and beautiful in all of our children's hearts, and allow the guiding principles of the Quran and the Sunnah, and the reality of the Quran and the Sunnah, the way of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to be what animates and informs and dictates every single thought, action, and behavior in all of our lives, in our homes, in our hearts, in our institutions, our organizations, our masajid, our nations, our ummah, and the entirety of the creation. Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim. We ask you, Ya Allah, to bless our organizations, our institutions, to allow Yaqeen to truly be a prophetic organization and institution, one that truly seeks to serve your deen and attain your pleasure. Ya Allah, bless every single person who works in this space, every single person who's volunteered, every single person who's donated, every single person who's shared something or has advocated for something. Ya Allah, we ask you to elevate the rank of every single person who seeks to serve your deen, Ya Allah. And we ask you to use us for your deen and choose us for your deen. Guide us and guide through us and make us a source of guidance for others. And Ya Allah, we ask you to grant Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa sacredness and sanctity. one that is palpable in a way that everyone around it will tremble. Mm-hmm. Ya Allah, you are Al-Kabir, Al-Muta'al, you are the Almighty One. And you know the haqiqah of what is transpiring, the reality of what's transpiring in that land, and the aggression and the oppression and the abuse and the evil that is transpiring on that land, the desecration of your sacred. Ya Allah, anta rabbu dhaka al-bayt, wa lil-bayti rabbun yahmi. You are the Lord of that house, and the house has a Lord that will protect it. We ask you to protect al-Masjid al-Aqsa, and to protect our brothers and sisters in al-Masjid al-Aqsa and around al-Masjid al-Aqsa, and allow the international community to see how evil what is transpiring there is, and use us all, Ya Allah, of good hearts and good minds and good conscientiousness, Ya Allah, to serve your deen and to serve your sacred sanctuaries. Ya Allah, use us and do not replace us, use us and do not replace us. Protect our brothers and sisters across the world, east to west, that our Uyghur brothers and sisters, our brothers and sisters in Kashmir, our brothers and sisters in India, our brothers and sisters in Yemen, our brothers and sisters in Iraq, our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan, our brothers and sisters in the Balkans, our brothers and sisters from east to west, the ones that we know and the ones that we do not. We ask you to protect them and to envelop them in your sacred grace and mercy and lutf, and to rid this world of tyranny and oppression and of vile, vile, evil abuse. Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim. We ask you, Allah, to grant us a husnul khitam, a beautiful ending to this Ramadan, and a husnul khitam, a beautiful ending to our lives, Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, and allow the happiness that the Prophet ﷺ spoke about to be the one that envelops us at the end of Ramadan, and grant us, Ya Allah, the greatest of joy and the greatest of happiness, and that is ladhatun nazari ila wajhika al-kareem. The day that when we all meet you, Ya Allah, we ask you to allow that to be the greatest moment of our lives, when we, the beatific vision, when we see you, Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, grant us that reality, Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim. Wa salli Allahumma ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa akhi wa da'wana, and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Jazakallah khair. Allah barak fikum. I really appreciate that, and I think that's the most beautiful way to end. And Khadija was trying to come in and to get in on your dua, subhanAllah.
Sayyidah Khadija, dua for my, always present.
She indeed is, so inshallah, make dua for her. And I apologize for any disruptions, but she's next year she might just take over the chair and start teaching. So, I really appreciate you coming in. This was a last minute idea, by the way. We said, you know, let's just, Sheikh Abdullah, why don't we actually get together and you know, for the last one. So we appreciate everyone. Barakallahu fikum. And I don't want to spoil the end of that beautiful dua. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you, Sheikh Yasir, and bless all of you. And inshallah ta'ala, may Allah allow you all to have a blessed Eid, and we will see you all around, inshallah ta'ala, and keep us in your dua. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The benefit of that suhbah, of that coming together to learn, is not merely the imparting of information and the receiving of information or the discussion that takes place. It's people coming together to feel that tranquility from Allah, and to also feel like they can talk about Allah in a safe and a thoughtful space. And we've structured these conviction circles over the period of a semester so that these modules actually take into consideration that student's schedule, so that you feel like there's something that you're working towards every time you start a module. And by the end of it, you feel like you've gained some literacy in that topic. And at the same time, you've identified the proper parameters that are given to us through the tradition as to how we should look at these issues. And you also have some mature discussion and the bonding that takes place through that mature discussion with other classmates and other students that probably have the exact same concerns and the exact same questions about our tradition. Our goal is not just to have a place for critical thinking. We also want to encourage self-reflection. This is not just some sort of intellectual playground. This is meant to be a camp for self-development, because we believe at Yaqeen that conviction directly leads to contribution.